Glory to God. Good morning. Good morning. Glory to God. I want to welcome everyone to this live. Let's just be the first. I'm going to be the first to join this morning, and I'm going to shout your name. Abby! Abby's the first to join this morning, and then the rest. Everyone, I repeat, I hope you all have my book. I think we're in Acts chapter 10 today. I'm going to go straight into our declaration, Acts chapter 10. I clean the drunk here with me this morning. We're here every morning, clean the drunk, teaching the word of God. It's your first time joining us? Oh. Glory to God. Acts chapter 10. We're going to make our declaration and go to Acts chapter 10. That's where we're at this morning. Is Acts just such a long book? Well, Acts chapter 10 is where we're at this morning. Acts chapter 10. We're going to make our declaration and go to Acts chapter 10. Amen. Amen. We're studying the book of Acts chapter 10. Glory to God. Glory to God. Amen. Amen. Just waiting for people to join in this evening. We're going to be having a great time at Midweek Koinonia. Yeah. We're going to have a great time at Midweek Koinonia this evening. We're going to be praying, teaching. I have some questions. Some of these questions are old questions that have been answered before, but we have new members. And so I don't mind going back and keep teaching and keep teaching and keep teaching. Until we all get it. So this evening is going to be interesting. I don't want you to miss this evening. I don't want you to miss tomorrow evening if you're on the mainland. Mainland church tomorrow evening is going to be awesome. I don't want you to miss Sunday morning, which is our mid-year Thanksgiving. Sunday morning mid-year Thanksgiving is going to be awesome. Sunday morning mid-year Thanksgiving is going to be awesome. Sunday morning mid-year Thanksgiving is going to be awesome. It's really going to be awesome. But this evening is going to be powerful. I don't know why you all don't come for Wednesday evening. We're going to spend 1 hour praying apostolic Christocentric prayers for 1 hour this evening. And then we're going to delve into question and answer sessions. I already have some questions. If you do have questions you want me to treat this evening, can you send me a DM? And we'll treat your questions this evening by the grace of God. By God's grace, sometime in July, we're going to have the Wednesday for the book reading and book review. Book reading and book review. You will love it. It will bless you. You will love it. It will bless you. We'll have a book review and a book reading on Wednesday, sometime in the month of July. Please, don't miss any service. As God is up to something. There is a transitional phase right now that I think we're going through, and it is very powerful and also apostolic this season. I don't want you to miss this season. God is up to something. It will change your life completely. God is up to something and it will change your life completely. Amen. Amen. So in Acts chapter 10, before we start studying the book of Acts chapter 10, we want to read our, make our morning declaration. Mirabel Flourish Peters. Which one is Mirabel? Doc, and change that handle quickly. Mirabel Fome Peters. Happy birthday to you, Mirabel Fome Peters. Mirabel Peters. Happy birthday to you. Which one is Mirabel? Duncan. Mirabel Fome Peters. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to Pastor Larry. And every one of you, happy birthday, happy birthday, happy birthday. Some of us come from all the way overseas. So if you're in Lagos and in the area and you don't go, it's not a good look. It's not a good look. If people travel all the way just to be there in the service. Let's take our declaration this morning, then we can delve into what we're doing this morning, Acts chapter 10. Have your Bibles, get your writing materials together. Pastor Larry, happy birthday to you, Pastor Larry, the incredible Pastor Larry, my son on the gospel. God bless, God keep you. I want you all to find Pastor Larry's DM and send him something on his birthday. And I'm serious. DM Pastor Larry, send him something. Today is his birthday. Send him something on his birthday. Today is Pastor Larry's birthday. He's my PA, he's one of my assistant pastors, he's my son. Send him something on his birthday today, okay? Send him something on his birthday. Pastor Larry, God bless you. We'll respond to you on this glorious day that you were born. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Our declaration, are you ready for this? Are you ready for this? One, two, three, go. Declare, I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. All my sins are forgiven. I am passionately loved by God. I am powerfully helped by God. I am kept and protected by God. I enjoy angelic assistance. I am irrevocably blessed. I am eternally forgiven. I am the healed of the Lord. I enjoy divine health. I have the favor and the wisdom of God. I am fruitful. I flourish, excel, and prosper in all that I do. Nothing is against me. Nothing dies in my hand. I am never stranded. All things are working together for my good. God loves me more than the devil hates me. Grace is working for me. Amen. We're going to do that one more time. We're going to do that one more time. Okay, are you ready for this? Are you ready for this? We're going to do that one more time. One more time. One, two, three, go. I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. All my sins are forgiven. I am passionately loved by God. I am powerfully helped by God. I am kept protected by God. I enjoy angelic assistance. I am irrevocably blessed. I am eternally forgiven. I am the healed of the Lord. I enjoy divine health. I have the favor and the wisdom of God. I am fruitful. I flourish, excel, and prosper in all that I do. Nothing is against me. Nothing dies in my hand. I am never stranded. All things are working together for my good. God loves me more than the devil hates me. Grace is working for me. Glory to God. We're going to do it one more time. I want you to do it. I hope these declarations we make every morning is not just one regular declaration. Say it because your body and your cells are taking note of what you're saying to yourself. Your body and your cells are taking note of what you are saying to yourself. And these declarations are powerful. Thou art snared by the words of your mouth. That's what the Bible says. The righteousness of faith, speak it. That's what the Bible says. If thou shalt say, you shall have it. That's what the Bible says. When you decree a thing, it shall be established. That's what the Bible says. And so it's important that you make these declarations to yourself. That you're not just sitting like a pillar of salt or just watching me perfunctorily. That you are engaged as we make this declaration this morning. It is important. Is the declaration, Pastor Cherish, is a declaration that you guys must keep saying, even in the Abuja church. Is our prayer point daily. My flesh responds to the word of God that proceeds out of my mouth. You know, and that's the truth. Your flesh responds to the word of God that proceeds out of your mouth. And please, somebody remind me to break down this declaration this evening and in church so that you can understand what you're saying. It was not just, I was not just thinking of what to say and I'm just rhyming them. No. There's something in this declaration that is powerful that we must always see. There's something in this declaration that is powerful and we must always see. Always, always say it. Always, always, always say it. Glory to God. Glory to God. So one, two, three, go. I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. All my sins are forgiven. I am passionately loved by God. I am powerfully helped by God. I am kept and protected by God. I enjoy angelic assistance. I am irrevocably blessed. I am eternally forgiven. I am the healed of the Lord. I enjoy divine health. I have the favor and the wisdom of God. I am fruitful. I flourish, excel, and prosper in all that I do. Nothing is against me. Nothing dies in my hand. I am never stranded. All things are working together for my good. God loves me more than the devil hates me. Grace is working for me. Now you can shout glory. Amen. Amen. Let me shout my own. Yes. Amen. 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 Acts chapter 10 is what we're doing. Can we do the declaration one more time? Just one more time for people who just joined. I hope you have this declaration. I hope it's something that you say to yourself all the time. I hope it's something that you acknowledge to yourself all the time. I hope it's something that you align your life to all the time. Like I think it was Ezekiel just mentioned, my body responds to the word of God that comes out from my mouth. Your cells, everything is responding to the word of God that comes out from your mouth. So don't mess up with it. You can have a bad dream and you are looking for how to pray about the dream. Just read the declaration. One line of the declaration will cancel that dream that you had. We reprogram your mind in the right direction. So let me give you an example. And so you had a dream that people try to attack you in your dream. What line in the declaration solves that dream? Let me ask you guys. What line in the declaration solves that dream? You had a dream. Oh, they were trying to attack you. What line in this declaration solves that dream? Let me ask you. You had an attack in the night. People try to attack you. What line in the declaration solves that you can use to respond to that dream? You felt like you were being attacked in the night and you woke up. What line in the declaration? Let me find out who's sensitive enough to pick it. One, nothing is against me. I am kept and protected by God. That's it. Nothing is against me. Two lines there. I am kept and protected by God. Those two lines are good. Especially, I am kept and protected by God. Then you add, nothing is against me. That's it. I am kept and protected by God. Nothing is against me. So you had the dream, for instance, and you know, nothing is against. I am kept and protected by God. That's it. So let me give you another example. So you had a dream where you lost money or something left your hands. What part of the declaration deals with that? You had a dream and something left your hand and you lost money, you lost something. What part of the declaration deals with that? Someone even added, I'm powerfully helped by God. That's one. So nothing dies in my hand. Come on, Tolani, you're there. Nothing dies in my hand. Nothing dies in my hand. Nothing dies in my hand. No, you understand? Nothing dies in my hand. That's one part of the declaration. So you can literally wake up and you don't know what to pray about something, and then you can make this. You find that you're in a tight place and things are difficult for you in your dream or in your life. What part of the declaration sorts it out? You are in a tight place and it looks like things are difficult for you. What part of the declaration sorts it out? You are in a tight place and it looks like things are difficult. I am never stranded. I am fruitful. You see, I flourish. That's it. Especially, I'm never stranded. All things are working together for my good. So it's a comprehensive. I enjoy angelic assistance. Beautiful. So it's not just something that I put this thing together by the Spirit of God. I can tell you for free. I put this declaration together by the Spirit of God. And it's going to be on every page in my next book. Please watch out for my next book. Save towards it now. My next book is Pray As You Go, the Daily Declaration. It will bless you. Oh my God. It will bless you. It will be released in December so that you can speak into your new, you can start speaking into your new year. It will bless you. It will bless you. It will bless you. I'll release it in December so you can start speaking into your new year. Start loading. Start releasing into your new year. Pray As You Go is my next book. It's not a book to have one copy. You must have one copy in your car, one copy in your house, one copy at work, so that every time you are praying as you are going, you are releasing as you are going, you are declaring as you are going. It's Pray As You Go. Amen. Amen. Pray As You Go, my next book. It will bless you. It will bless you. Get ready for that. Get ready for that. Get ready for that. Let's make our declaration one more time. Rekia Yusuf. Let's make our declaration one more time and then we can go into Acts chapter 10. 1, 2, 3, go. You already know this. Let's say it together. 1, 2, 3, go. I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. All my sins are forgiven. I am passionately loved by God. I am powerfully helped by God. I am kept and protected by God. I enjoy angelic assistance. I am irrevocably blessed. I am eternally forgiven. I am the healed of the Lord. I enjoy divine health. I have the favor and the wisdom of God. I am fruitful. I flourish, excel, and prosper in all that I do. Nothing is against me. Nothing dies in my hand. I am never stranded. All things are working together for my good. God loves me more than the devil hates me. Grace is working for me. Glory to God. Glory to God. This declaration we posted this morning, the last one we posted was not complete. So we're going to post this one now. And when we post it, I want you to repost it. I want you to share it with your friends. I want them to see it. I want you to repost it. I want you to share it with your friends. Get them to see it and send the message out there, this daily declaration. Amen, 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 amen. Glory to God. I want you to post it. I want you to share it with your friends. I want them to see this daily declaration all the time, every time, in the name of Jesus. So we just posted the daily declaration. Please make sure you share it. Talk to people about it. Amen. Amen. Oh my God. Oh my God. Glory to God. Glory to God. It's on our page. So make sure you talk to people about it. Post it. We took down the last one. So please share this declaration. It's on our page as soon as this is done. Save it. Share it as soon as this is done. Yeah, I think he's even pinned down. Fantastic. He's pinned down. Teller, I don't know how you did that. You have to teach me that. Amen. You have to teach me that. Amen. Glory to God. Let's go to Acts chapter 10. Father, bless your word in Jesus' name. Amen. In Jesus' name, amen. Acts chapter 10. And there was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius, a centurion of the band. The band there is not a music band, though. It's a cohort. That's the word. Acts chapter 10. It's already there. Yeah, Acts chapter 10. Yeah. A devout man and one that feared God. One that feared God. God with all his house and gave much alms to the people and prayed to God always. He gave much alms to the people and prayed to God always. Verse 3, he saw in a vision, evidently about the ninth hour of the day, an angel of the Lord coming into him and saying unto him, Cornelius, listen. And when he looked on him, he was afraid and said, what is it, Lord? And he said unto him, thy prayers and thy alms are come up for a memorial before God. A prayer and an arm has come up as a memorial before God. And now send men to Joppa and call for one Simon, whose son name is Peter. He lodged with Simon a tanner, whose house is by the seaside. He shall tell thee what thou oughtest to do. Watch this. Watch this. Watch this. Watch, it was like a sect of the law enforcement at that time. Fantastic, you got it. So when you talk about Barnabas, the leader of a group of soldiers. Now watch verse 6. He lodged with one Simon, a tenor, whose house is by the seaside. He shall tell thee what thou oughtest to do. So the fact that he was prayerful, he feared the Lord and was giving alms, he still did not know what to do. But that prayer brought him to the man who will show him what to do. God always uses men to show you what to do. Talking in front of you is an apostle of God's grace that God has sent to you to show you what to do. And it's clear in scripture. And when the angel which spake unto Cornelius was departed, he called two of his household servants and a devout soldier of them that waited on him continually. And when he had declared all these things unto them, he sent them to Joppa. He sent them to Joppa. On the morrow, as they went on their journey, he drew nigh unto the city. Peter went up upon the house to pray about the sixth hour, and he became very hungry and would have eaten, but while he made ready, he fell into a trance and saw heaven open and a certain vessel descending unto him, and it had been a great sheet knit at the four corners and let down to the earth, wherein all manner of four-footed beasts of the earth and the wild beasts, creeping things and fowls of the air. And there came a voice to him, "Arise, Peter, kill and eat." "Arise, Peter, kill and eat." "Peter, kill and eat." But Peter said, "Not so, Lord, for I have never eaten anything that is common or unclean." So the opposite of holiness is commonness. I want you to get this. The opposite of holiness is commonness. What is holy is something that is uncommon. So Peter was calling uncleanness, which is unholy, uncommon. Common. So the opposite of holiness is commonness. You are common. So when you say you are holy, it means that you are uncommon. I am not regular. I am separate. Holiness is separate. The sanctification is set asideness. It's not sinlessness, it's set asideness. God has set you aside. So you are uncommon. Your business is uncommon. It's set apartness. Thank you very much. I got the word from, thank you, Zini. It's set apartness. Holiness is not sinlessness, it's set apartness. To be holy is to be set apart. So Peter was saying to God, "I will not eat anything that is not set apart." That these things are common. But God was trying to teach Peter grace. So Peter was a lawman who called some things unclean. And the voice spake unto him again and the second time, "What God has cleansed, thou call that call not thou uncommon." That, so the meaning of common is not holy. The meaning of holiness is that you are uncommon. So decree over your life and your family, your business. I decree and declare that I am uncommon. I am set apart. I am not regular. My business is uncommon. The Lord's church is uncommon. In the name of, I am uncommon and I am set apart in the name of Jesus. I am uncommon and I am set apart in the name of Jesus. I was born to stand out. I'm not born to be regular. I am uncommon and I'm set apart. Amen. And the voice spake unto him again a second time, "What God has called clean, please do not call unclean." Give me a minute. Hafiz, you guys should stop. Give me 30 minutes. I'm having a meeting. It's disturbing my meeting. Thank you. Sorry, guys. Verse 16. It was done thrice. That means this was said to him three times. And the vessel was received up again into heaven. Verse 17. Now Peter doubted in himself what this vision which he had seen should mean. Behold, the men which were sent from Cornelius had made inquiry for Simon's house and stood before the gate and called and asked whether Simon, which was surnamed Peter, was lodged there. While Peter thought on the vision, the Spirit said unto him, behold, three men seek thee. Behold, three men seek thee. Arise, therefore, and get thee down. Go with them, doubting nothing, for I have sent them. God is not a gossip. God spoke to Cornelius. God spoke to Peter. God spoke to Cornelius. God spoke to Peter. So by the time both of them met, they all knew what thus says the Lord is. They all knew what God was saying. Are you with me? Can you see this? So nobody was confused. So God sent you to me. God already spoke to Peter. Cornelius, somebody's coming to seek you. God already spoke to Cornelius. Go and meet Peter. So God is a master communicator. When God communicates, you are not confused. God is a master communicator. He spoke to Cornelius about Peter and spoke to Peter about Cornelius. So when they met, nobody was confused what thus says the Lord is. That's why I say to you all the time that the prophetic word should not be breaking news to the believer. It should be confirmation to the believer. Because when God spoke to Cornelius, he copied Peter. When God spoke to Peter, he copied Cornelius. You are never confused when you hear a prophetic word from God. So by the time they met, it was they got it. It reduces the explanation. You're never confused. God is a master communicator. God knows how to communicate. His introduction is God said. God said. So don't meet anybody who gives you a word from God and you're like, what's this? Then you now go home. Somebody told me how a pastor said, you know, I'm just telling you, don't try. You have everything in life, but you won't marry. Marriage is not part of what God has given to you. That straight up is rubbish. The Bible says he has come that we may have life and may have it more abundantly. God is a master communicator. God doesn't speak mysteries. He speaks clearly. The Bible says the Spirit of God speaks expressly. So God speaks expressly. God speaks clearly. God speaks precisely. God speaks accurately. God knows how to communicate in your language. He will speak to you in the codes and in the ways that you will understand. Are you hearing what I'm saying? So God is a master communicator. Yeah? So God spoke to Cornelius. God spoke to Peter too. Verse 21. Then Peter went down to the men which were sent unto him from Cornelius and said, behold, I am he whom ye seek. There was no confusion. I am he whom ye seek. What is the cause? Wherefore are ye come? And they said, Cornelius the centurion, a just man, one that feared the Lord and of good report among the nations of the Jews, was warned from God by a holy angel to send for thee unto his house to hear the words of thee. So they sent for Peter. They sent for Peter. Then called he them in and lodged them. And on the morrow, Peter went away with them. And certain brethren from Joppa accompanied Peter. So Peter went with an entourage to see Cornelius. Cornelius sent for Peter. He was a man of status. He was a strong man. Like I said to you yesterday, you must know how to treat your kings. And the morrow, after they entered into Caesarea, Cornelius waited for them and had called together his kinsmen. So Cornelius gathered his people to hear, his relatives, to hear what this guy had to say. And Peter was coming in. Cornelius met him and fell down at his feet and worshipped him. Cornelius, who was the chairman, saw Peter and worshipped. So even the king recognized the apostolic office. I really have no respect for kings who don't understand apostolic office. This man, because he was a prayerful king, he knew how to honor. There are people who don't know how to honor their pastors. They don't understand it. They can't grasp it. They can't get it. But you see it in scripture. They don't know how to honor their pastor. If in their mind, their pastor is their guy. To be, pastor now, pastor. And because he's a common, gracious person like me, you do not understand that your sense of value determines the flow of virtue. See what Cornelius did. On the morrow, Cornelius waited for him and had his kinsmen, 25. And as Peter was coming in, Cornelius met him and fell down at his feet and worshipped. Cornelius, this was the general. This was the general. It was not Peter bowing to Cornelius. It was the king, the officer, the bowing. And because you have a very gracious pastor who's just, hey, what's up now? People don't get it that your pastor's graciousness should not lose your sense of honor for him. Your pastor's graciousness should not make you lose your idea and your sense of honor for him. Your sense of value determines the flow of virtue. So your pastor's graciousness and his demeanor, because he's just a regular, shouldn't make you lose your sense of honor and what you how you should honor him. And it's there in scripture. And the pastor should not take this for granted, because look at Peter's response. And Peter took him up saying, stand up. I myself also am a man. That's humility. So he honored Peter. Peter didn't say, lie down there. Do it properly. You have not done it well. Peter responded and said, no. Stand up. I myself am a man. So it was honor both ways. But one person gave honor first. The other one received it graciously and did not swim in it as if he was thirsty for honor. He was humble. But the fact that you have a humble pastor doesn't mean you should lose your sense of honor for him. You understand what I'm saying? You shouldn't do that. Peter said, no, stand up. And I'm teaching, I hope you, these people understand what I'm doing. I'm teaching lines upon lines, precept upon precept. I make boast that I don't know any pastor or any ministry doing this every morning to his audience. I don't know. What you all just want to hear is, amen, amen. Give me a word, amen. Whoosh, amen. Ah, it was very hot today. It was very hot today. Then you sow a dangerous seed, and then that's over. No, I'm teaching you Bible. I want to get you to grow. I want you to see properly. I want you to be deep in Christ. Glory to God. And hope you appreciate it. Verse 27. And as he talked with him, he went in and found many that were come together. Verse 28, and he said unto them, ye know how that it is an unlawful thing for a man that is a Jew to keep company or come unto one of another nation. But God has showed me that I should not call any man common or unclean. So what was God trying to teach Peter in the dream? God was trying to teach Peter this meeting, that don't go there and be calling people unclean. No, people that have called clean, do not call them unclean. So when Peter got into the house, he said, man, okay, I get it. Yeah, I get it. And one day, because we're a growing church, we're third year, and I need to start teaching honor, because I was not big on those things about honor. People don't know how to honor their pastor. They just take things for granted. And honor is both, it's not just the dobale. No. Don't do those hypocrisy. I would detect it from a mile away. Honor is with your time, is with your substance, it's with how you treat your pastor. But he doesn't eat it and then stays there. He just gives it back to, we give it back to God. So Peter got the message now that, don't call anyone unclean. God was teaching him grace versus law. Verse 29, therefore came I unto you without gainsaying. As soon as I was sent for, I asked therefore what intent ye have sent me. For Cornelius said, 4 days ago I was fasting until this hour. And on the ninth hour I prayed in my house, and behold, a man stood before me in bright clothing and said, Cornelius, thy prayer is heard. Thy prayer is heard. And thy arms are in remembrance in the sight of God. Send therefore Joppa and call hither Simon, whose surname is Peter. He is lodged in the house of one Simon a tanner by the seaside, who when he cometh shall speak unto you. Immediately therefore I sent to thee, and thou hast well done that thou art come. Now therefore are we all here present before God to hear all things that are commanded thee of God. Then Peter opened his mouth and said, of a truth, I perceive that God is no respecter of person. This happens. That means if God can speak to you, he's no respecter of person. That's what Peter said. God is no respecter of person. But in every nation, he that feared him and walketh righteously is accepted with him. The word which God sent unto the children of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. That's what I say. Ye know which was published through all Judea and began from Galilee after baptism, which John preached. Peter self was learning, yes. Verse 38, how God anointed Jesus Christ of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good. Doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. So Jesus went about doing good, not doing evil. So God does not do evil because Jesus never did evil. I will say that again. The nature of God is in Christ. Go and get my book and don't just get it as a decoration on your dining table or by your bedside. Make sure you are reading. The man who has my book and does not read is not different from a man who cannot read. So if Jesus did not kill, if Jesus did not hurt anybody, he went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. That means what God did is that he heals and delivers people from oppression. He does not kill. For God was with him. So how do you know that God is with you? It's because you heal and deliver people from oppression. Glory to God. And we're all witnesses of all things which he did, both in the land of the Jews and Jerusalem, whom they slew and hang on a tree. 40. Him God raised up the third day and showed him openly. Not to all the people, but unto witnesses chosen before God, even to us, who did eat and drink with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach unto the people and to testify that it is he which was ordained of God to be judge of quick and dead. 43. To give all the prophet witnesses that through his name whosoever believeth in him shall receive remission of sins. So is it clear what the Lord wanted to show Cornelius? God wanted to show Cornelius the power of the gospel, which is what? Forgiveness of sins. So God sent Peter to preach to Cornelius about what? Forgiveness of sins. God sent Peter to preach to Cornelius about what? Forgiveness. God sent Peter to preach to Cornelius. As soon as Peter, watch this. Don't be distracted. 43 and 44 is important. As soon as Peter mentioned to him, give all the prophets witnesses through his name, whosoever believeth, isn't it? I hope you're still here. Whosoever believeth in him shall receive remissions of sin. While Peter yet spake this, the Holy Ghost fell on all of them which heard the word. So what triggered the Holy Ghost to move? The forgiveness of sins. Glory! As soon as, whilst Peter was speaking about forgiveness of sin, when he was talking about history, the Holy Ghost didn't move. When he was talking about the visions, the Holy Ghost didn't move. When he was talking about the journey, the Holy Ghost didn't move. Whilst he spoke about the forgiveness of sin, the Holy Ghost fell on all of them. As he spoke about Ephesus, forgiveness of sin, the Holy Ghost fell. As he spoke about salvation, the Holy Ghost. So if you want to see the Holy Ghost move, speak Ephesus. Declare your sins are forgiven. Declare God loves you more than the devil hates you. Declare the gospel. And then you see the move of the Holy Ghost. Jesus. While he yet spake about forgiveness of sins, the Holy Ghost fell on all of them which heard the word. The word. What is that word? All your sins are forgiven. God loves you more than the devil hates you. All your sins are forgiven. As you receive, believe in him and you shall receive forgiveness of sins. Receive, oh my God, forgiveness of sins. We will never be tired of preaching that all our sins forgiveness of sins through the power of his name. That's what TPT says. Whilst Peter was just talking about forgiveness of sins through the power of his name, through the power of his name, my sins. So if you want to feel the Holy Ghost, just declare, all my sins, Ushama, are forgiven. The Holy Ghost will start jerking inside of you because he's a witness to that which the work of the Son is and the will of the Father. The will of the Father is that the work of the Son will be done. And that's the witness of the Spirit. That's the entirety and the totality of the Scripture. The will of the Father, the work of the Son, and the witness of the Spirit. What is the will of the Father? That the Son would die. What is the work of the Son? That he died. What is the witness of the Spirit? That the Son died. So every time you preach forgiveness of sin, guess what? The Holy Ghost wells up. Who? From within you. I feel the anointing. I feel the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Just preaching, all your sins are forgiven. All your sins are forgiven. All your sins are. So the witness of the Spirit is showing you that the Father had a will. And that will was worked out by the Son. Because all your sins are forgiven. Verse 45. And they of the circumcision which believed were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because that of the Gentiles also was poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. So these were not even Jews. The Gentiles was poured out. This is the first time Peter is speaking to the Gentiles. I know Peter doesn't really, he's not a Gentile guy, he's a Jew guy. But he's the first guy who released the Holy Ghost to the Gentiles. For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. Then answered Peter, can any man forbid water, that this should not be baptized, which have received the Holy Ghost as well as we? And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord. Then prayed they him to tarry certain days. The Holy Ghost has already come upon them, but Peter was still in the law. He wanted water baptism to add to the Holy Ghost. Like I said to you, Acts is the details of the early church. He had some of their mistakes, but you never seen these mistakes in the book of Romans, in the book of Ephesians. Those are core epistles. Acts is not a core epistle. But I hope with these few words of mine, I've been able to convince you and not confuse you that every time you preach forgiveness of sins, the Holy Ghost witnesses forgiveness of sins. Glory to God. Glory to God in the highest. Glory to God in the highest. I said, glory to God in the highest. I just want you to know that all your sins are forgiven. Let's make our declaration one more time and then we can close. Don't miss this evening. It's going to be powerful. Don't miss this evening. It's going to be powerful. I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. All my sins are forgiven. I am passionately loved by God. I am powerfully helped by God. I am kept and protected by God. I enjoy angelic assistance. I am irrevocably blessed. I am eternally forgiven. I am the healed of the Lord. I enjoy divine health. I have the favor and the wisdom of God. I am fruitful. I flourish, excel, and prosper in all that I do. Nothing is against me. Nothing dies in my hand. I am never stranded. All things are working together for my good. God loves me more than the devil hates me. Grace is working for me. It's your boy, Pastor Flourish from the L.O.G.I.C Nation. Never forget, God loves you more than the devil hates you. I want to see you this evening in church. I'm going to spend 1 hour, don't be late, 6 to 7, praying apostolic Christocentric prayers. As we come into July, I sense something. I sense a transition in the Spirit. I sense a release. I sense assignment be given to people. I sense instructions being downloaded to people. I sense great wealth being released to people for the cause of the ministry. I sense an abundance. There is a deluge in the realm of the Spirit and is about to drop on the L.O.G.I.C Church and the L.O.G.I.C Nation, and it will be said that this is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our sight. The people of the old said, eyes have not seen. They said, ears have not heard. They said, it has not entered into the hearts of man what God is about to do. But we know it in our spirit. We can tell it in our spirit that we are at the precipice of the greatest move of God in this time. And I dare you to believe God, that God is up to something in your life. I want to see you this evening. I want to see you tomorrow evening on the mainland. And on Sunday morning, our mid-year Thanksgiving. So, it's going to be good on Sunday. Sunday's word is classic. is going to bless you beyond your imagination. I love you all. I'll see you this evening. Blessings. And tomorrow morning, 9 a.m. I love you. Blessings.